Dean Tony, this is the first time that President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. saw a decline in his approval rating since he rose to power in 2022. First, would it be fair to say that the honeymoon period for the new administration is already over this early?
Well, it's just one cycle, God, so I think it's premature to say that. On the other hand, it is a steep fall, 15 points, it's a big thing. On the other hand, having majority support of the people is still, you know, something to work on, right? So let's not exaggerate this while it's important, and it provides an opportunity to the opposition, if any, to, you know, and that means even the Duterte camp that might be in conflict with the Marcos camp. It's an opportunity to shove a wedge, you know, further make that fall. On the other hand, Marcos can, I think, make up for this by doing the right thing, especially with inflation, especially with agriculture, with food, you know, the basic things, because that explains the fall. People are hard off right now.
All right. Dean Tony, you mentioned inflation and agriculture. Pulse Asia Chief Ronald Holmes also cites this as one of the main catalysts for the decline in the president's approval ratings. How is this tied to his performance as agriculture chief?
Well, it's a non-performance, really, because he did not really pay attention to that. We've told him for a while already. I mean, columnists, pundits, but also people close to him, that he needs to appoint. They're saying they're going to appoint one now, Mr. Laurel, so we'll see if that works. Very challenging job, because you have to balance production and consumption needs. If you address consumption alone, you will sacrifice our farmers. And in the end, that will redound back against us, that will bounce back against us, because then you will have no food security, having no food production here in the Philippines. On the other hand, if you protect our farmers from imports, prices are going to rise. So it's really kind of basic and very challenging to find that balance.
All right. Dean Tony, there are also calls for the president to axe or to rescind the appointment of several of his economic managers, even with his sister, Senator Aimee Marcos, supporting those calls. Politically speaking, how wise or how crucial would it be for the president to heed those calls as of this moment when the Philippines continues to battle the rising prices of basic commodities?
It would not be wise to do that, because that's going to be a restart. They start from scratch again. What I think needs to be done is those officials need to do a restart themselves in their departments. That's what is needed. In other words, my point is, even if you replace those officials, I guess that's Secretary Jokno of Finance, Secretary Balisakan of NEDA, Secretary Pascual of the Treasury, Economic Managers, right? If you replace them, those officials start from zero. At least these officials, the current officials, what they need to do is recalibrate, right? Learn from their mistakes or gaps from the last year. At least you don't start from zero. That's my point.
All right. Aside from inflation, also some of the issues that were covered when the survey was conducted include the 2024 budget deliberations, issues on the West Philippine Sea. The President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has a stronger stance when it comes to defending the Philippine sovereignty in the West Philippine Sea compared to his predecessor, former President Rodrigo Duterte. Now, I'm curious, why wasn't that performance, particularly his strongly worded statements in ASEAN, as well as the more proactive actions of the Philippine Coast Guard and the Philippine Navy in the West Philippine Sea, why weren't those efforts insufficient to somehow offset the Filipinos' frustrations when it comes to inflationary issues?
Well, it's quite obvious why. What affects people the most are the issues of the stomach, right? Issues of livelihood, issues of hunger, food prices. That everything is trumped by that. So, and I support everything that President Marcos has done in the West Philippine Sea. I have a lot of admiration for the courage of and creativity of Secretary Gilbert Chutoro in doing the right thing here. But that's not very important to the people, right? I mean, compared to the price of rice, for example. Now, the budget deliberation in the next cycle could be very important, because that's where the confidential and intelligence funds will come out, and the scandalous nature by which our government, especially the Office of the Vice President, has handled the money of the people. That's really scandalous, and it hits directly to the people, because they're going to compare themselves. Wala silang pera, they don't have any money, they can't buy food, and here is the government spending, you know, 125 million pesos in 11 days in just one office alone. So that will have a very impact in the next round. I think this was not included in this round.
And interesting that you mentioned confidential funds, because in this particular survey, the issue of the confidential funds of the Office of the Vice President was not covered when the survey was conducted. Now, to what do you attribute the decline of approval ratings of Vice President Sara Duterte, since, as mentioned, the issue of her office's questionable spending of confidential funds was not yet covered by this survey?
And that's her performance in the Department of Education, I think, more than as Vice President. Very bad performance on INDAPED, in my view. And she's not really qualified to be an Education Secretary, so I think it was a mistake for her to accept that and for the President to appoint her in that position. So eventually that's going to reflect on her own popularity as well.
And similar question to earlier, how wise would it be for the Vice President to let go of the Department of Education's portfolio at this point in time for her career, for the sake of her career?
It should not be for the sake of her career, Kat. We shouldn't be holding office for the sake of careers. Should hold office for the public service, and I should think she should let go because, you know, this is not her field. And it's so important for the future. And if we already missed 2 years, we already did very badly during the pandemic, 2 years. If all these 6 years of the Marcos government is going to waste for education, we lose eight years of educating our kids properly.
And aside from her performance as Education Secretary, and of course what's at stake there, the issue of her questionable spending of confidential funds continues to be a hot topic for weeks now. Do you expect her approval and trust ratings to further dip?
Yeah, that should reflect on her in the next round, you know. Although the caveat there is the Duterte's, both, especially President Duterte during his time, and I think even VP Sara has a Teflon effect, right? Like, you know, you criticize them all they can, they can do all the mistakes, but they're still impervious. So I don't know if in this case, this is so scandalous, right? To spend 125 million 11 days and most of the people cannot afford good rice. Grabe ang contrast na.
Interesting that you mentioned that you described this as scandalous. Would you say that this would somehow significantly affect her endorsement powers come the 2020 come the midterm elections, considering that that's happening in about a year?
It should, but we'll see. No, I mean, the conventional wisdom among pundits is that this is a fight between the Bongbong Marcos camp and the Duterte camp, allied with former President Bacapagal Arroyo, and in fact Senator Amy Marcos, and on the other hand Speaker Martin Romualdez and President Marcos. So we'll see. Unfortunately, the unfortunate part of this is that there is really no opposition except the Makabayan legislators who've done a wonderful job on the budget, really as fiscalizers. Never seen such brilliant and courageous interventions as we have seen with Gabriela Representative Arlene Rosas, ACT Teacher Representative Franz Castro, and Kabataan Representative Raul Manuel.
All right, since you already mentioned the Makabayan Bloc, let's talk about the performance of Congress. The Senate and the House of Representatives managed to somehow retain their approval and trust ratings. But then Pulse Asia noted that there seems to be an ambivalence to the performance of Congress, particularly in the Visayas. How would you explain that, Dean Tony?
I wouldn't know the geographical reasons, but the ambivalence has always been there for the House and the Senate, unless there's a major issue. And the problem with the House and Senate is they do not show any independence, you know, especially the House, to the executive. That's always been, and that's not the fault of Speaker Romualdez. Always been the case. You know, when people say we are like the American system, that's not true, because our House is basically always under control of the President. Are saying it a little bit more independent, but you know, in the world of supermajorities, very barely independent. So people see them and, you know, don't care what they really do, because anyway, they're not really, they're just doing what the President wants.
All right. And before we let you go, Dean Tony, while it is a double-digit drop, a significant decline, some camps still argue that the numbers of the president and the vice president are still relatively high. It's way above the 50%, the 50% mark. What is the administration doing right at this point in time for them to retain those high numbers?
Well, that's why I said, you know, it's premature to say the honeymoon is over. You know, I'm not gonna say that it's hard to say what they're doing right, except to say that this started as a popular government. The election results had showed the margin, huge margin. It's gonna take a while to change that, and it take a while for you know, the issues, the gut issues to make people give up on a government. So that's we've seen that cycle now for a while, or since President Aquino, Noynoy Aquino, President Duterte, now, that most of the time the president stays above water. Aquino dipped a lot after Mama Zapata. And not because of that, but because his actions after seemed to show that he did not care.
And we seem to be having some technical difficulties there, but we would like to thank political analyst Tony Lavinia for giving us some of his time this morning and joining us in the program.